Good afternoon to all the students. So in this session we are going to discuss some new terminology, very important terminology that is related to the security. And remember that this is very important question, right? This is a very important concept, and you may expect one question from this particular topic, right, in the examination. So forget about the examination point of view, but what you will gain by listening to this particular topic is you will come to know lot of terminology that is related to the security, very important terminology. So as I told that when you are aware of the subject security, you should know some terminology, you should have very good idea on the terminology that is involved inside these security concepts, right? So you will come across lot of security terminology over here. So in the yesterday's class we started our discussion with the security. Can anybody tell me what actually is the security? What is the corresponding term? Super, right? So the security is nothing but protection. How you protect the data that is present in your system, or how you protect the information when you are transferring the information from one end to another end. So that is called as the security. So how many types of securities we have seen? In what areas the security can be applied?
Security, network security, data security, information.
That is related to the information technology sector, right? If you take the landscape of the IT, that is information technology, you can apply this security to the data, you can apply this security to the information, network, internet, everywhere you can apply this application security. Like that you can apply it. But before that, this security is a general term that can be applied to the IT field, or you can apply it to the monetary financial field, or you can apply it to the political, personal, everywhere you can use it, right? But as I told that we are more concerned towards the IT sector only. How you are going to protect the data, how you are going to secure your system physically, and how we are going to secure our transmissions from one end to another end. So all these terms related to the security concerned about the IT infrastructure, right? And after that we have gone through the security goals. What are the three security goals we have? Very important concept. What are the three security goals we have?
Confidentiality, integrity, availability,
sir. Super, right. We call it as the CIA triad, where C stands for the confidentiality, I stands for the integrity, and A stands for the availability, right? So can anybody give me the relative term to the confidentiality?
Disclosure, sir.
Super, right. Disclosure. So if you protect your data, or if you protect your system from unauthorized disclosure of the contents to the unauthorized parties, right, you won't allow your content or your data or your information to be disclosed to unauthorized parties. That term we call it as the confidentiality. So what is the synonym, or what is the equivalent term for the integrity?
Modifications.
So if you won't allow the third parties or the unauthorized users to modify the data in your system, or to modify the information that you are transferring from one part of the communication to another part of the communication, we call it as the integrity. So once the sender sends a message to the other end, hi, hello, the same message has to be received by the receiver. If such happens, if communication happens in such a way that whatever message that is sent by the sender is exactly received by the receiver, then we call it as the integrity, right? So what is that availability?
Sir, availability.
Right. So the services should not be denied to the authorized users. You always deny the service for the unauthorized users. But once you say that he is an authorized user, you must make that service, or you must make that server, or you must make that resource available to the authorized users all the time. So that is called as the availability. So these three terms are called as the security goals. Security goals, right? So we'll see these three terms again and again until we complete this topic, right? So this is all about what we have discussed in yesterday's session. And in today's session, as I told that we are going to enter into one more topic, which is called as the security attack, the security mechanisms, and the security services. First, we will see what the security attack is. Similarly, we will see what the security mechanism is, and what are the security services, and how we can implement these services. All these terms we will discuss in the today's session. Is it clear?
Sir.
Yes, sir.
So,
yes, sir.
Can anybody tell me what do you mean by an attack?
Action performed by unauthorized users to the database, to retrieve database.
Right. So it is an action that is performed by an unauthorized user. It is not only to retrieve the data from the database, it may be to disrupt the service to the genuine user. Right. So don't think that attack is always done on the database. So if you don't make the database to be available to the authorized users, that is also considered as one of the attack only. But anything that makes the authorized users not available to the authorized users, we call it as a security attack, right? So an action that is performed to disrupt the services to the authorized users is called as a security attack, right? So we have different types of security attacks here. We'll see the different types. One is the crypt analysis attacks. So the security attacks are classified into two classes. One is the crypt analysis attack, and the second one is non-crypt analysis. Right. So we'll see what this crypt analysis is and what this non-crypt analysis attack is. We'll see what are the terms that come under this non-crypt analysis. What actually is the crypt analysis? All these terms we'll discuss right now, right? So after this, we have the security mechanism, right? What do you mean by security mechanism? Right, so once we have the attacks here, so assume that a particular system has been attacked by a third party or unauthorized user. So what action you are doing to recover the system, the attacked system, or what action you need to perform to prevent them from the other unauthorized attacks, right? So prevention, how do you prevent the attacks? How do you detect the attacks? And how do you recover from the attacks? All these terms, we consider it as the security mechanism, right? So it is a process that you apply to the system, or that is a process to apply to the communication system to prevent, detect, and recover the security attacks. That is called as security mechanism. Now coming to the third term, which is called as security services. So these are nothing but the services which are used. Like you can use the tools, or you can use the software programs, right? So these services are considered to be a counterpart to these attacks, right? So once an attack has been occurred, or assume that an attack is going to occur, so you should take some measures to protect your system, or you should take some measures to protect your communication channel. So all these measures, we call it as the services, right? So we have a lot of security services which we'll discuss. So how can you implement these services? Means we can implement these services by making use of the mechanisms, right? So one service, so if I say that I have a authentication service,
we'll see what this authentication is, what this authorization is, everything, right? So let us say a authentication service. So how do you implement this authentication service means you are going to combine one or more mechanisms. So again, you will take this security mechanisms and you combine this mechanism one and mechanism two. So these two combinations of these mechanisms will give a service, a security service, right? It's not only the limited to one mechanism or two mechanisms or three mechanisms. It depends on the service which we are providing. Right. So simply remember that a service is nothing but a combination of mechanisms. That's it. Right. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So after studying all these things, finally what we will do is we will give a table where we will compare, or not the comparison, we will give the analogy between the security mechanisms and the security services. So what services are created by making use of what mechanisms? So that we will study and we will end up this topic. Right. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So yes, coming sir. To the three aspects of the information security, as I told that in the yesterday's class itself, InfoSec is a shorthand representation of information security. So the three aspects of this information security are security attack, security mechanism, and security service. As we have discussed, the security attack is an action that compromises the security of information owned by an organization. You can write it in your own words also, right? Any action that is done against a target is called as the security attack, or any action that is used to compromise the security of the organization, you will call it as the security attack. Like that, you can give your own information. The concept here is you should be able to understand the term security attack. You simply remember that it is an action that is used to target, or an action that is created by the third party user to compromise the security of the information owned by an organization. Like that, you can give your own definitions also. And coming to the second term, which is called a security mechanism. As we have discussed, that a mechanism that is designed to detect, prevent, and recover from a security attack. So once you have a security attack, an unwanted action has been performed by the unauthorized user to your system. So you should detect that attack, or you should, after detection, you should recover your system from that security attack. So all these things are called as the security mechanisms. And the last term we have is the security service. As I told that, the service that enhances the security of data processing systems and information transfers of an organization, we call it as a security service. And this point also, we have mentioned that the services are intended to counter security attacks. So whenever system has been attacked by a third party user, you should have some counter actions, right? So if somebody is targeting us, or if somebody is beating us, we should give some counter attack, right? So in a similar fashion, whenever your organization is attacked by the attackers, you should have some mechanisms, or you should have some services to counter those security attacks. So all those things, we consider it as the security services. So the services are intended to counter the security attacks, and they make use of one or more security mechanisms. As I told that, how do you prepare a security service means a security service is nothing but a combination of one or two security mechanisms, one or more security mechanisms. Right. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Now coming to the other part of this security attacks, we are calling it as the cryptographic attacks. Right. We'll see what this cryptography is once we complete this particular topic. So cryptographic attacks means These are also the actions that are performed by the unauthorized users to compromise the security or to breach the security of a particular organization. Right. So there are two types of these security attacks. We can also call them as the two types of cryptographic attacks. One is the crypt analytic attacks and the second one is non-crypt analytic attacks. Right. So these are the two classes of this cryptographic attacks. This is a very important question for your examination point of view. So explain two classes of cryptographic attacks. The first one is the crypt analytic and the second one is the non-crypt analytic. So can anybody tell me what do you understand by this term crypt analytic? Any idea?
No, sir.
Super, right. No, sir. So crypt analytic, you can understand this term. What do you mean by analytic or analysis?
Research.
Estimation.
Right. So whatever data you have, you thoroughly go through those data or whatever data logs, everything you will go through it thoroughly. And by making use of that data, you are going to analyze what actually has happened, right? Or you are going to analyze why it has happened, right? And what is the reason to happen for those particular attacks? So that is called as the analysis. You thoroughly go through some particular type of data and then you will find solutions for these problems. What actually has happened? Why it has happened? What are the reasons for that one? So that is called as analysis. Right. So for this analysis, can anybody tell me what is the subject that you need for analyzing? Any wild guess you have? Right. So when you want to do some analysis part, you should have a strong grip on the mathematics. So the concept or the subject which we use for the analysis part is the mathematics. Right. So for example, you may use the probability. Right. You may use the integer arithmetic. Or you may use some other thing like matrices. Or you may use the modular arithmetic. Like that you have different parts. Or you can use what is this one? Algebra. You can use the algebraic structures also. Right. So you have different parts of this mathematics. So when you use these mathematics concepts to analyze the things, we call such type of things as the crypt analytics. So you are going to analyze the crypt. Crypt means we'll see, right? It is a term which is derived from the cryptography, crypt. So whenever you change one form of data into another form, we call it as the encryption. So that is called as crypt. So what do you understand by the term crypt analytic attacks? Any idea now? You try to explain what do you mean by crypt analytic attacks. Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Me, what do you understand by the crypt analytic attacks now? I told you what analysis is. I told you what for we, by making use of what subject we will do this analysis. So now tell me what is this crypt analytic attacks? Say yes or no.
Sir,
Sir, can you please explain once again, sir?
So by looking at this term, crypt analytic, if you divide it into two parts, crypt is one term and the analytic is another term. So what analysis means is we will thoroughly go through the data and we will find the solutions or we will find the answers for some of the questions like what actually has happened, why it has happened, what are the reasons for these attacks, all these things we will do. So for analysis part, we require the knowledge of mathematics. Like we require the knowledge of probability. Sometimes the probability is used for the analysis part. Sometimes the integer arithmetic is used for the analysis part. Sometimes the algebraic structures are used for the analysis. Most of the time we will use this modular arithmetic for this analysis part. Right? So all these are mathematical concepts which we will use to do some analysis in order to find the reason for what, why and reasons. Right. If you apply this analysis for the cryptography, which we call it as the crypt analytic, crypt analysis. Right. So now tell me, what do you understand by this term crypt analytic attacks? So you go from the right hand side. So if I explain this, for example, these are the attacks which involve the mathematical concepts. That means the attacker is very much interested in these cryptanalytic attacks. He should have some idea on the mathematics. So he may apply the probability theory or he may apply the modular arithmetic on the cryptography to get the information. That is called as the cryptanalytic attacks. So if the attacker is making use of the mathematical concepts to attack the system, such type of attacks we call it as the crypt analytic attacks. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. Yes, sir.
So the second class of cryptographic attacks are non-crypt analytic. Right. Here the attacker attacks the system not based on the mathematical concepts. There's no need to have the mathematical idea. But he is going to compromise the security goals. What are the security goals we have? Three security goals.
Confidentiality, integrity, availability, sir.
Yeah, you can simply say it as CIA triad, right? So these are the three security goals we have. So in the non-crypt analytic attacks, the attacker is not interested in doing the mathematical calculations and he is not interested to use the mathematics concepts. Right? He will directly attack the three security goals. He will compromise the confidentiality of the system. He tries to compromise the integrity of the system or he tries to compromise the availability of the system. So if the attacker is concentrating on attacking these security goals of the system like CIA triad, we call such type of attacks as non-crypt analytic attacks. Is it clear? So crypt analytic means making use of the mathematics concepts to understand the information. Non-crypt analytic means it is nowhere related to the mathematics part and it is used to attack or compromise the security goals like the CIA triad. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. So we'll go deep into this crypt analytic and non-crypt analytic. So coming to this crypt analytic, we'll just have an idea of what this crypt analytic is, attacks are. And while you go through the subject, you will come to know the different crypt analytic attacks that we can perform, right? But for the present point of time, you just remember that the crypt analytic attacks are the attacks based on the mathematics, right? And the attacker is always interested to know the key. Do you know anything about this key?
No, sir.
Right. So let us understand the simple concept of communication. Let us assume that we have two parties. S is for sender and R is for the receiver. Right. And these two parties, the sender and receiver, are connected with a communication channel. right, try to understand this particular concept. They are connected with a communication channel, and this communication channel may be a connection between different networks, right? This may be network 1, this may be network 2, and this may be network 3. Is it clear up to this point? We are just making use of the communication channel to connect the sender and the receiver. And assume that the sender is sending a message. Right. So this is the message he wants to send to the receiver. And through this communication channel, this message is going to pass through the different networks and it is going to reach the receiver. Right. Up to this you are clear, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So this is the actual message M, and assume that this message M has been received by the receiver. Right. During the transmission of this message from sender to the receiver, it has crossed different networks. It has crossed the N1, it has crossed N2, and it has crossed N3. Right. So in this network, assume that there is an attacker here. In the network N1, we have an attacker, right? He is a person, right? Don't assume that an attacker is always a person. It can be a computer also, right? Or it can be a server like that. Don't assume that it actually attacker is a person. Even you can make use of the computers to attack the things.
Sir.
Yeah, please.
Even a computer, server, then handle sales.
Your voice is breaking.
Sir, ఇప్పుడు అక్కడ ఉన్నది సర్వర్ అయినా గానీ లేకపోతే కంప్యూటర్ అయినా గానీ అది యాక్చువల్ గా హ్యాండిల్ చేసేది ఒక పర్సన్ ఏ కదా సార్.
Yeah, but the thing what I'm trying to say is the person plays the main role, but one thing he can do, he can write a simple program and he can store it in the server, and the server will keep track of everything. Is it possible or not?
Yes, sir.
So he writes some malware program and he loads it into the server. So once a message from the sender S is transmitted through the communication channel, the server will automatically invoke itself based upon the program, and it can attack the message. If it can happen, then there is no need for the person, right? So ultimately the person is responsible, but there is no need for the physical presence of the person. That is what I am trying to say.
Okay, sir. Right.
So assume that the attacker is present in this N1 network, and while the message enters into this network N1, message M enters into this network N1, the person attacks this message. That means he will just read the contents. So we will see what the disclosure is. That means he wants to compromise the confidentiality. Right. So sender wants to send some secret message to the receiver R. So he has mailed it through a message M. But the attacker that is present inside this network N1 has attacked the communication channel or message, and he is trying to compromise the confidentiality. That means he wants to read what contents the sender S is sending to receiver R. So that is an attack on confidentiality. There is another attack on integrity, let us say. So what do you mean by integrity?
No modifications allowed in the middle, sir.
Right. So compromising integrity means the attacker is allowed to modify. For example, assume that the user has sent hi Rajesh. The sender has sent hi Rajesh. So in compromising the confidentiality, the attacker is interested to know what content has been sent from the sender to the receiver. So he will just open the card, he will just open the message, and he will see that, okay, the sender is sending a message called Hi Rajesh, right? So by this reading of the message, the attacker is trying to compromise the confidentiality. But when coming to the concept of integrity, the attacker that is present at the network N1, he takes the message M, which consists of "Hi Rajesh," and he tries to modify it. So when modification occurs by the attacker, when modification takes place by the attacker, then we say that we are compromising the integrity. Right. So instead of "Hi Rajesh," I will scold something. Right. I will write "Stupid Rajesh." Example. So the attacker will change it to "Stupid Rajesh." And when this message is received to the receiver, that is R, so when he opens it, the receiver will see a message called "Stupid Rajesh." Right. So like that, the attacker can make his own modifications to the actual message. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So the first concept which I have told is related to the confidentiality, where the attacker is interested to know what contents are transferred from one party to the another party. That's it. He is not interested to make modifications. That is called as compromising the confidentiality. But in the second case, the user is interested to know the concept or to know the message, what message has been sent from the sender to the receiver, and he is also interested in modifying that message also. That is compromising the integrity. If it is clear, we will see what this key is. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
So the attacker is interested to know what contents are sent by the sender to the receiver. So he will just attack that message and he will read the contents. Right. But the sender is not interested. The sender and receiver, the two parties of the communication, are not interested to disclose the contents to the third party, to disclose the contents to the unauthorized party. So what they will do is, they will use a concept called as cryptography. Listen carefully. They will use a concept called as cryptography. So what this cryptography means, let us forget about the definitions of this cryptography and all these things. A cryptography is nothing but a combination of encryption and, decryption. So what is cryptography? It is a combination of encryption and decryption. So we should know what this encryption is. So encryption is nothing but a process of converting the plain text into cipher text. So what is this plain text? What is this cipher text? We'll discuss. Everything we'll discuss, right? So, and the decryption is the process of converting the cipher text into plain text, right? So the cryptography is a combination of encryption and decryption, where encryption is the process of converting the plain text into the ciphertext, and the decryption is the process of converting the ciphertext into plain text. Right. Now we will see what is this plain text and what is this ciphertext. Let us see what is this plain text and ciphertext. So the sender S is interested in sending a message called "Hi Rajesh." This particular message is called as plain text. Is it clear? The actual message which is going to be sent to the receiver by the sender is called as the plain text. Right. So this plain text, if you send directly to this receiver through the communication channel, if the plain text "Hi Rajesh" is sent from the sender to the receiver using this communication channel, the attacker that is present in network N1 can attack the message and he can read the contents. Why? Because it is in the simple plain text. He can understand that language. English is understandable by everybody, right? So "Hi Rajesh" is understandable by the attacker. So thereby he is compromising the confidentiality. But this time, in this case, the sender and receiver, they are very strong enough. They don't want the contents to be disclosed to the attacker. So what they want to do is, they want to convert this plain text into a text, another text, which is not understandable by the attacker. Right. So this another text is nothing but the cipher text. So instead of sending the plain text which is readable by the attacker, the sender, he will convert, before transmission itself, he will convert the plain text into another text which is not understandable by the attacker. So that another text which is not understandable by the attacker, we call it as the cipher text. Is it clear? So the sender will make use of the encryption technique at the sending side. So what he will do before transmitting the message, "Hi Rajesh," he is going to convert this plain text into cipher text, which we will call it as encryption, and that message will be sent through the communication channel. So once the encrypted text, assume that encrypted text looks like this, some dots, dashes, something like that. Right. Even though the message is attacked by the attacker at network N1, even though he reads the message, since it is in a language which is not understandable by the attacker, he will not get any information about the actual plain text. Right. So what is the technique that we have to use to make it non-understandable by the attacker?
Encryption.
Right. And once this message is received at the receiving end, the receiver R has to perform the decryption. Right, the receiver R has to perform the decryption. So decryption means, what message is received? Is it the plain text or cipher text?
Cipher text.
The receiver has received the cipher text. So in order to understand what actual contents are, he should convert the cipher text into plain text. Right. So the conversion of cipher text into plain text is called as decryption. So what is the technique that we need to use at the sender side?
Encryption, sir.
Right. So at the sender's site, we will make use of the encryption technique. And at the receiver side, what is that you have to use?
Decryption, sir.
Right. So these are the two techniques we will be using during the communication between the sender and the receiver. But we never come across this key. Now we are entering into this key. What actually this key is, right? So for encryption, we are saying that we are going to convert the plain text into cipher text. Okay. But how we are going to convert? So in order to convert the plain text into cipher text, we need to use a key. Right. So assume that this is locked. So encryption is the process of converting the plain text into cipher text. For conversion of plain text into cipher text, we need to use a bit pattern called as the key. Right. So when you want to do encryption, you will use a key and you will encrypt it. Encryption is nothing but plain text into cipher text. You will encrypt it, and once the cipher text has reached the receiver end, you will use the same key. Listen carefully, this is very important. You can use the same key to decrypt. What do you mean by decryption? Conversion of ciphertext into plain text. Right. So for conversion of plain text into ciphertext, we will use a key, which is nothing but a bit pattern. That's it. Nothing more than that. Right. A sequence of zeros and ones is called as a bit pattern. So we will use that key, and we will use some functions, mathematical functions, to encrypt, that means to convert the plain text into ciphertext. So at the receiver end, we can use, listen carefully, this term is very important, we can use the same key for conversion of ciphertext into plain text. Or we can use another key. So this is K1. Assume that it is K1. And this is another key K2. So the first case is, what is case one here? We will use K1, same key for encryption, and the same key used for the decryption also. And in case two, we will use different keys. K1 is used for encryption, and K2 is used for decryption. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
See, listen carefully. Now, case one. Let us take case one. So, in case one, we are going to use the same key for encryption and decryption. That means for encryption, that means for the sender, if he wants to convert the plain text into ciphertext, he will use K1. And at the receiver side, for conversion of ciphertext into plain text, that means the decryption, he will use the same key K1. Right? So that is called as symmetric encryption. Symmetric cryptography, or we can also call as symmetric key cryptography. Symmetric means, what do you mean by symmetric? Similar.
Equal part. Equal part.
Similar. Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
So if you use the same key for the encryption and decryption, it is called as the symmetric key cryptography. What is the other part? If you go for case two, what is case two here? We are using different keys. K1 is used for encryption and K2 is used for decryption. So when we are using different keys for the encryption and decryption, that particular type of cryptography, we call it as asymmetric key cryptography. Asymmetric means dissimilar. So if you use dissimilar keys for encryption and decryption, they are called as asymmetric key cryptography. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
So do you understand what for this key is used?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So the key is used for encryption as well as for the decryption. The key is nothing but a bit pattern. How you are going to encrypt, how you are going to decrypt means there comes the algorithms. So we have lot of encryption and decryption algorithms. Right. So all these algorithms will make use of the keys concept. So once you want to convert the plain text into ciphertext or ciphertext into plain text, you have to make use of these keys. Right. Coming back to our concept again, coming to the crypt analytic attacks. What actually is crypt analytic attacks? Anybody please repeat.
Using mathematical
function concepts to attack the data.
Right, super. So when we use some mathematical concepts to attack the party or to attack the system, that is called as the crypt analytic attacks. And the main reason for attacking or the crypt analytic is they want to know the key. Right. Crypt analytic attacks always happens to identify the key. That is important. Right. So once the key is known, can you get the plain text or not?
Yes, sir. Right. Yes, sir.
So when you are sending, when the sender is sending the message, he just locks it with a key and he will throw that message through the communication channel. Even though the attacker has attacked through in between the communication channel, since he does not have a key, he cannot open that message or he cannot read the contents of the message, he cannot modify the contents of the message. So this particular key is very important. It plays a very vital role in the cryptography. So all the cryptanalytic attacks, they are based on knowing the key. Once you know the key, everything is compromised, right? Is it clear? So here I am saying that in the symmetric key cryptography, there is only one key at the encryption end and at the decryption end. But how do the receiver know that K1 is the key that is used by the sender? Right, once you are locking with one key, K1, how can the receiver know that K1 is the key that is used for the encryption? So the same K1 can be used for the decryption. How can the receiver know? Means there are some mechanisms where the sender can send the keys to the receiver. That is a different concept. Right. So up to here, if it is clear, we can move forward. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Right.
So coming to the cryptanalytic attacks, as I told that these attacks are the combinations of statistical and algebraic techniques aimed at knowing, ascertaining the secret key of a cipher. So as I told that a script analytic attacks makes use of the mathematical concepts such as statistics, algebra, matrices, modular arithmetic. They may use a lot of mathematical concepts, and all those concepts are used to know the secret key. So here the secret key is compromised, right? So the objective of the crypt analysis, very important term this one, crypt analysis. The objective of the crypt analysis is to find the properties of the cipher which does not exist in a random fashion, right? So every key differs from another one. So if you have two different keys, K1 is having a different bit pattern and K2 is having a different bit pattern. Similarly, K3 is having different bit pattern and KN is having different bit pattern. So the main objective of the crypt analysis is you do lot of mathematical operations on the data that is available, and the main target is to identify the key. Right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So once the attacker knows the message, he will try a mathematical concept and he identifies that key one is the key. He will try to decrypt it with that message. So this is my message, right? Which is locked. This is locked. In order to know the contents of this message, he should know the key. So what the attacker will do is he will try lot of apply mathematical concepts, and he assumes that K1 is the key for the message. He tries to apply this key to this message, and if it is correct, then K1 is identified as the key. The entire security is compromised. Am I right or not? Once you are having the key, the entire confidentiality is lost. Right. So once this K1 is tried, if it is successful, then the security is compromised. If it is not successful, he applies some other concepts. He means, who is that he here?
Attacker, sir.
Super. The attacker will apply some other concepts and he will try another key 2. If it is also successful, then key 2 is taken as the key. If it is unsuccessful, then he will apply another mathematical concepts and he will try to find another key. Like that, he keeps on trying in a random fashion. Right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So if the property is detected and the guess is correct, then the entire security is breached. Otherwise, the next guess is tried based upon application of different mathematical concepts, right? And one more term here we will come across here is this one, brute force attack. Very important term in the cryptography, brute force attack, right? So let us have a small discussion on this brute force attack, what this brute force attack is. For example, assume that the key consists, what is key here? I told you what is the key here.
Encryption and decryption, sir.
Okay, it is used for encryption and decryption, but what actually is key? What are the contents of a key?
Bit patterns.
Super. It is a bit pattern. Right. So it is a combination of n bits. As I told that it can have a combination of zeros and ones. This is very important. Please keep it in mind. Right. Key is nothing but a bit pattern. It can be of n bits. For example, let us take a very simple example. Let us assume that the key size is 2. What do you mean by key size?
Number of bits in the key size.
Super, right. So key size is equal to 2 means this represents the number of bits. So for two bits, how many combinations can we get? Zeros and ones combinations.
Four combinations.
It is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. For example, if I take the key size as 3, how many combinations we'll get?
9, sir.
It is 8, not 9. Right. So we will get like this: 000, 001, 010, 011, 100, 101, 110, and 111. So we have 8 combinations here. Is it clear? Now, if I take the key size as 4, tell me how many combinations we have.
16, sir.
Super. Right.
2 power 4.
So if you have n bits for a particular key, the number of possible combinations are 2 power n. Here it is 2 cube and here it is 2 square. And if I take 5 bits, what is the value? It is 2 power 5 and is equal to 32 combinations. Right. So if it is an n bit key, how many combinations are there?
2 power n, sir.
Super, right. It is 2 power n combinations, right. So forget about all these things. Let us take a very simple example where I have taken the key size as 2 only. So how many combinations are there?
4, sir.
Right. See, listen carefully. Let me clear this. So when the attacker gets the message which is encrypted and assume that the key is only 2 bits, so what he will do is he will try this 00 on this message. If it is successful, that means if the attacker is successful in opening the contents and reading the contents, then 00 is identified as the key. Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
If it is not successful, if 00 is not successful in opening this message, what he will do? He will try the other combination. He will try 01. He tries to open it with this message. If it is unsuccessful, he will try to open with 10. If it is unsuccessful, the last combination is 11 only. So definitely it will open the message. Right. So if you take the key size as 2, which means that the key takes only 2 bits. So there are only 4 combinations. So the attacker's work of attacking the message becomes very easy. Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
So by this, you please tell me whether what size of the key should be there for having the strong encryption and strong decryption. Is it the small size is enough or we need to have the large key size?
Large one, sir.
Large key size.
So if you keep on increasing, for example, let us take the key size as 3. How many combinations are there? 8 combinations, right?
8, sir.
So he will try 000. Then he will try 001, 010, 011, 100, 101, 110, and 111. Like that, he will try a lot of combinations. So the scope of exploration of these combinations is increased by making the key size increase to more number of bits, right? So you can have the secured environment whenever the encryption algorithm is having the large key size. Very important point, Amma. Please try to concentrate. So how can you say that a particular encryption algorithm is very strong? One of the simplest parameter is you just look at the key size that the algorithm is using. For example, assume that X1 algorithm I have developed. Right, I am using a key size of only 2 bits and X2 another algorithm is using 3 bits. And let us take another algorithm A3. Let us take it as algorithm 1, algorithm 2 and algorithm. It is using 8 bits of key. Now tell me which one is strongest algorithm.
A3, sir.
Why? Because we are making use of a strong key here. A strong key is nothing but when we make use of more number of bits for representing a key, that becomes a strong key. When the key is strong, the algorithm ultimately becomes the strong. Right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
So if it is 2 bits, with the key size is 2 bits, he can try, the attacker can try only 4 combinations. Very simple task. If the key size is 3, he has to try 8 combinations. If the key size is 4, he has to try 16 combinations. Like that, when you increase the size, the work you are putting on the attacker is increased. Right. So coming back to our discussion, brute force attack. Brute force attack means trying all the possible combinations is called as the brute force attack. Right. So what is the maximum value of this key size 2? How many combinations are there?
4, sir.
Four.
So if the attacker tries all these 4 combinations, then we call it as a brute force attack. Similarly, if you take the key size as 3, what can be the brute force attack? How many combinations he has to try?
8, sir.
4 means, 4 bits means 16 combinations he has to try. 5 means 32 combinations he has to try. Like that, if the key size is n bits, how many combinations he has to try?
2 power n combinations.
So if we make the attacker to try all the possible combinations, listen carefully, all the possible combinations. So in this case, it is 2 power n combinations. If the attacker makes use of 2 power n combinations to try the key or to be successful in getting the key, that is called as the brute force attack. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
An attack is theoretically successful if the guessing complexity is lesser than the brute force attack, right? So for example, if you take the key size as 2, so totally he has to try 4 combinations, am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
But in the second combination, for example, is 0, 1, the attacker is successful in getting the key. So that is, we say that it is theoretically successful. The attack is theoretically successful. Why? Because brute force attack, as we have discussed, that this is not that much easy. Brute force attack is a very complex task, right? We will see while discussing the algorithms, right? Why this brute force attack is practically infeasible. It is not at all possible for the brute force attack, right? Even though you have a very sophisticated supercomputer also you have, but the brute force attack with a large key is not at all feasible, right? So is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. So once you start attacking the message, once you start trying the various combinations of the keys, at one point you will definitely get successful. That means at one point the attacker, you means the attacker, the attacker will be definitely successful in identifying the key. Once the key is identified, as I told that, entire message is compromised. So the key plays very important role, right? So in the real life also, we will come across these keys. How do you secure your gold items? You will put it in locker, right?
Yes, sir.
So you will put it in locker and you will lock it. So once you lost your key, it is gone. Every gold item you have will be compromised. It is lost. Am I right or not? In the similar fashion, in the communication of information from one party to another party, the key plays very important role. The key plays very important role in the encryption and decryption. Therefore, securing the key is very important. Once you secure the key, everything is safe. But once the key is compromised, everything is compromised. That is the role of a key. Right? So all the crypt analysis, what they are trying to do? Crypt analysis, what the attackers are trying to do?
By using mathematical functions, they
are using... By using the mathematical concepts, what is that they are trying to get? Is it the message or key?
Key, sir.
Super, right?
Key, sir.
They are not attacking the message. In order to know the message, they want to get the key. So these attacks are mainly intended to know the keys. Right? So once you attack one by one combination, right, at any point you will be successful in getting the key, and once you are successful, you will, the entire security is breached. Right? So or else you may get a chance to identify a flaw in the design, and by using this flaw you can surely attack it in the future attacks also. Right? So this is all about the crypt analytic attacks. Is it clear?
Yes sir.
So this is end of today's session. And thank you one and all.
Thank you, sir.